Welcome to the Deep Dive. Today we're really zeroing in on critical surgical procedure, common carotid endarterectomy.
Right. We're talking about those vital arteries heading to the brain.
Exactly. And what surgeons do when those arteries get significantly narrowed, it's a key way to prevent strokes.
Precisely. And today we're going to unpack the, you know, the core surgical techniques involved, how vascular surgeons actually go about clearing that blockage in the carotid artery.
Yeah, the goal is reducing that stroke risk dramatically. We're focusing squarely on the how, the procedural side of things.
Mm-hmm. We've looked at some great sources guides on the vascular system, texts on potential complications, even operative dictations.
And we want to distill that down, right? Mm-hmm. Give you a clear, solid understanding of the main surgical approaches without getting totally lost in the weeds.
Exactly. And, you know, understanding these techniques really shines a light on the incredible skill involved in vascular surgery, how these interventions protect brain function.
Okay, let's get into it then. At the most basic level. What's the fundamental goal of a carotid endarterectomy? What problem is being solved?
Well, the main objective really is to remove atherosclerotic plaque. That's the gunk, fatty stuff, cholesterol, other debris that builds up inside the carotid artery lining.
The inner lining.
The inner lining, yes. And this buildup narrows the artery that's stenosis.
Right.
And that narrowing restricts blood flow, oxygen-rich blood, getting to the brain. Which, of course, seriously bumps up the risk of a stroke, specifically a thromboembolic stroke.
So it's basically a high-stakes plumbing job on a major artery. Okay, so our sources talk about a couple of main surgical ways to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start with the conventional approach, the open endarterectomy.
Yeah, the conventional or open technique, that's the most established one, the most common.
Okay.
It involves making an incision directly in the neck, gives the surgeon a clear view, direct access to the carotid artery.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a really critical step here is temporarily clamping the carotid artery.
Oh, clamping the artery to the brain.
Temporarily, yes. It stops the blood flow for a short time, which is essential. It lets the surgeon work in a field that isn't, you know, full of blood.
Okay, that sounds delicate.
It is, and they use sophisticated monitoring like EEG or measuring stump pressure to check how the brain is handling it during clamping. The aim is always to keep that clamping time as short as absolutely possible.
Right, right. Minimize risk. So once it's clamped, what's next?
Once clamped, the surgeon makes a careful incision along the artery, the arteriotomy, right over the narrowed area, the stenosis.
Okay.
That opens up the artery, exposes that plaque buildup inside.
And then they just scrape it out.
Well, scrape maybe sounds a bit rough. It's meticulous dissection. They carefully separate the plaque from the inner layers of the artery wall, the intima and media.
Huh?
You need really precise technique here. Get all the plaque out, but crucially, don't damage the artery wall underneath. They use fine instruments like special dissectors and elevators.
Got it. So plaque's out, artery walls hopefully smooth. How do they close it back up?
Good question. Sometimes they can just suture the incision closed directly, primary closure. But often, especially if the artery is a bit small or they removed a lot of plaque, they use a patch graft.
A patch? Like for jeans?
Huh, sort of, but biocompatible.
Mm.
It's a small piece of material, could be synthetic, like Dacron or PTFE, or sometimes a piece of the patient's own vein, maybe from the leg.
Okay.
And they suture this patch over the incision line. What it does, effectively, is widen the artery a bit at that spot, helps prevent it narrowing down again after the surgery.
That makes sense. Reduce the risk of restenosis.
Exactly. And throughout this whole open procedure, you know, careful technique is just paramount. You want to avoid bits of plaque breaking off and traveling upstream, avoid injuring the artery lining, and also watch out for the nerves nearby in the neck.
Yeah, there must be important nerves running right alongside.
Oh, absolutely. Cranial nerves. Damage could cause issues like hoarseness or tongue problems. So very careful dissection is key.
Okay, that gives a really clear picture of the conventional method. Now, the sources also mention eversion endarterectomy. How's that different?
Right. Eversion endarterectomy, it's a bit more specialized, often used when the plaque is really concentrated right where the internal carotid artery branches off.
Okay.
So in this technique, instead of just slicing along the artery, the surgeon actually divides the internal carotid artery, cuts it across just past the plaque.
Cuts it. Wow.
Yeah. Then they carefully turn that cut end of the internal carotid artery inside out for a short stretch, like pulling a sock partly off.
Turn it inside out.
Evert it, yes. And doing that gives an amazing direct view of the plaque lining the inside, especially right at that crucial branching point.
I can imagine.
So the surgeon can then peel the plaque off under direct vision. Some argue it allows for a really clean removal, especially if the plaque goes a little way up or down from that starting point.
Okay, so plaque removed from the everted section. Then what?
Then they carefully turn the artery segment right side out again and meticulously suture it back together, reconnecting the internal carotid to the common carotid artery. It's called reanastomosis.
Fascinating. A completely different mechanical approach. Are there specific reasons why a surgeon might choose Eversion over the conventional open method?
Well, the sources we looked at don't go deep into comparative trials, but the idea is that Eversion might be particularly good for plaque right at that bifurcation, or maybe if the internal carotid artery is quite twisted or kinked.
The anatomy matters.
Definitely. Turning it inside out can give better access in tricky spots. Some studies hint, maybe, at lower rates of the artery narrowing again, restenosis right at that specific spot with Eversion, but it's not definitive. Depends on the patient, the plaque, surgeon's experience, lots of factors.
Got it. Now, we're focusing on these surgical endarterectomy techniques, but we should probably briefly mention the alternative. Carotid angioplasty and stenting, CAS. How is that fundamentally different?
Right, CAS. It's important context. It's an endovascular approach, meaning inside the blood vessel.
No big neck incision then.
Correct. Usually they go in through an artery in the groin, the femoral artery. They thread a thin catheter up through the vascular system using x-ray guidance all the way to the narrowed spot in the carotid artery.
Okay.
Once there, they inflate a tiny balloon on the catheter tip that pushes the plaque flat against the artery walls, widening the channel.
Right, angioplasty.
Exactly. And then, usually to keep it open and stop it collapsing back down, they deploy a stent.
A stent, like a little metal scaffold.
Precisely. A small mesh tube that stays in place, holding the artery open.
So, catheter-based, less invasive in that sense, why is it important to know about CAS if we're focusing on the surgical options today?
Well, just because it is a major alternative, the decision between surgery, conventional or Eversion endarterectomy and CAS isn't always clear-cut. It really depends on the patient's overall health, other medical issues, the exact nature and location of the blockage, and frankly, the expertise available locally.
So it's part of the whole picture for treating carotid stenosis.
It absolutely is. Even though our deep dive today is on the surgical removal of plaque, you need to know CAS is out there.
Okay, that's a helpful distinction. Stepping back a bit now, beyond the specifics of technique, what are some of the really critical things surgeons have to consider during any carotid endarterectomy, whichever method they use? It's more than just the cutting and sewing, right?
Oh, absolutely. It starts way before the OR. Meticulous patient selection and really thorough pre-op evaluation are fundamental.
Like checking how bad the blockage is.
Exactly. Using things like duplex Doppler ultrasound that helps measure the stenosis, sure, but also looks at the plaque itself. Is it smooth, irregular, likely to break off? And it assesses blood flow patterns in the brain, all vital for deciding if surgery is the right call and planning how to do it.
And managing the patient's other health issues too, I imagine.
Critically important. Things like high blood pressure, diabetes, heart disease, they all need to be managed really well to lower the risks associated with the surgery itself.
Right. And what about potential pitfalls during or after the surgery? Complications must be a major concern in such a sensitive area.
Definitely. Vascular procedures always carry risks. With carotid endarterectomy, the big concerns during the operation include, well, stroke, either from a clot breaking loose or from reduced blood flow during clamping.
Yeah.
Also, heart attack risk and, as we mentioned, potential nerve injury in the neck.
And after the surgery.
Post-op, you're still watching closely for stroke. Also, bleeding or hematoma formation in the neck wound, infection, and that issue we touched on. Restenosis, the artery narrowing down again over time.
So constant vigilance is key, both during and after.
Constant vigilance, meticulous technique during the operation, and really close monitoring afterwards, checking neurological function, managing blood pressure, watching the wound. It's all part of the package.
And you mentioned restenosis, the artery narrowing again. That possibility of needing a redo surgery implies it's a real concern. What causes that?
It often comes down to something called neointimal hyperplasia. Basically, the artery lining reacts to the surgical injury by overgrowing smooth muscle cells. It's a healing response, but it can sometimes be excessive and narrow the artery again.
The body's response causing a new problem.
Sometimes, yes. Long-term management involves controlling risk factors, stop smoking, manage blood pressure and cholesterol, usually with statins, and often taking antiplatelet meds like aspirin.
To prevent further atherosclerosis.
Exactly. And patients often have regular follow-up ultrasounds to keep an eye on the artery. check for any signs of significant restenosis that might need another look.
Okay, so let's try and wrap this up. We've looked at the two main surgical ways to perform a carotid endarterectomy.
Mm-hmm.
The conventional open method incision, clamp, careful plaque removal, often a patch closure,
mm-hmm.
and the eversion technique, dividing the artery, turning it inside out for plaque removal, then reattaching it.
Right, a more specialized approach for certain situations.
And we've touched on the crucial importance of good patient assessment beforehand and the need to manage risks like stroke, nerve injury, and that longer-term issue of restenosis.
Precisely. These are technically complex procedures. They demand a huge amount of skill and judgment, but they are incredibly important tools for managing severe carotid artery disease.
Yeah, they play a massive role in preventing strokes, which can be just devastating.
Absolutely critical role.
It really drives home the complexity and the precision needed in vascular surgery. These aren't just abstract procedures. They have a huge direct impact on people's lives and health.
They really do. And maybe a final thought for you to consider. As our imaging gets better and better, letting us see plaque and arteries in even more detail,
yeah.
And as surgical tools and technologies continue to evolve, how do you think those advancements might further refine these endarterectomy techniques in the future? Could we see even better outcomes, fewer risks for patients needing this vital surgery?